So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy.
We sing that together. Here I am to worship.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down.
Here I am to say.
Here I am to say that you're my God.
You're all together.
You're all together.
Lift my voice and say
here
that you're my God.
You're my God.
You're all together lovely.
Here I am.
Amen. Let's just praise him. Let him receive us. Hallelujah. We know who we are. Hallelujah. We magnify you, Father. We glorify you. We lift you up. Hallelujah. King of kings. Hallelujah. Lord of lords. His great work, amen. And he raised us up with him and seated us on him in heavenly places, so that in the ages to come he might show his immeasurable and unsurpassing riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Jesus Christ. For it is by grace that we are saved. That we did, we ain't good enough. We just sitting in his grace and his mercy, and we're just thanking him. Hallelujah. We're thanking for his restoration and for his receiving. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Season. We're 3 weeks in. Hallelujah. And it is a season to lean in. Just lean in your children. Lean into God. In four directions, certainly prayer, and turning away from sin. I can't wait to see what Pastor preaches on today. He said it's just dropping like it's hot. Right? There's some big stuff. We just need to let it go, let it go, let it go, let it go. I'm like, Lord, this whatever the Holy Spirit though, let the Holy Spirit show you what it is. All right, don't no man don't need to do it. God, the Holy Spirit will do his job. Amen. And fasting so that we can remember God's suffering and then giving. I hope that during this season, this Lent season, that you get a good gift for God. You know, reach deep and get a good gift just to remind you of his sacrifice for us. Amen. Can I get agreement that before Easter, Resurrection Sunday, that you would get a good gift, open up a sacrificial for our Lord. Amen. Why don't you come? So our Lent reading this morning, why don't you stand with us, is in our mercy in our midst. He's such a good God. Certainly so much mercy.
God of mercy, your son faced trials and temptations in the wilderness. Strengthen us as we face the temptations of our time and grant compassion to all who call on you in their need.
To God who listens to our cries, we petition for peace in our broken world and for all who work for peace. Congregation, God of mercy.
For welcome and refuge for the displaced peoples of our earth. Congregation,
for reconciliation in families and in communities torn apart by hurt and fear, have mercy and reconcile us to you. Congregation,
we petition you for open and generous hearts during this season of Lent, so you may have your way in our lives. Congregation,
God of mercy, in our lives. For what else shall we pray and give thanks? Congregation, when you open your hands and lift up your face to God, and just lift up any burden that you're bearing right now or any petition out loud up to the throne of and thanksgiving to our God. I can't hear anyone. God, I thank you. Lift up your voice. Yes, Lord. He probably can't hear you all the way up in heaven. Y'all so quiet. Praise you, Jesus. Because you are better to us than we are to ourselves. Thank you.
Trusting in God, we, in the words of Jesus, pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us for the trespasses, as we forgive our trespassers. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. From thou is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Blessed be our God and our Lord Jesus Christ, who is merciful and exceedingly compassionate, who has reconciled us to himself and caused us to a new life by his grace. And congregation, blessed be his name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you.
Okay, so what a wonderful day in the Lord. We've been so excited that, you know, folks have been joining Brown Hutchison. And as the director of new members, Marilyn, you want to join me? Pastor, you want to join me? And so it's been exciting, you know, post-COVID to have so many that have come and joined us. We're so glad about it. And Marilyn so faithfully serves with me as teacher and leader, and she keeps all the books, all the records. But I want to lift up to you a young woman that joined, and she has faithfully completed her new members class. Lauren Harris, would you come? Amen. Yeah, give her some love. Praise God. Give her some love. Amen. Lauren has come week after week after week after week, and she is a delight to be with. We got some others who are almost on their way. You want to turn around to the congregation? Thank you. And I thought, and she's a little shy. And you know, Erica, I don't think that you ever come up here. So could you come with us? Yes, Erica Sheffield.
Amen, amen.
I'm just going to let, amen, amen. Ain't God good? That he increased their numbers. Amen, hallelujah. And I want to just give each of you a chance. First of all, why Brown Hutchison? What led you to Brown Hutchison?
Okay. The welcoming energy from Brown Hutchison captivated me on my first visit to the church. Instantly, I felt a sense of belonging and comfort. Reverend Jones' sermons consistently struck a chord with me, and I often share my positive experiences with others. I express gratitude to Brown Hutchison for embracing me warmly, creating a feeling of discovering my spiritual family.
Family brought me here, and it just felt right to stay here.
Amen, amen. God is good, you guys. And lastly, let me ask you this question. What did you think of new members class? So tell me what you got out of that.
I learned the whole experience was a highlight. I learned not just a lot about God, but more about myself.
And tell us what your spiritual gifts are, because one of the things we do is to make sure folks know what their giftings are.
Mercy, hospitality, and administration.
Y'all hear that? Amen. Amen. So make sure that you, if you ask her to do something, make sure she's in the right lane. Mercy. What was that again?
Hospitality and administration.
And administration. You can see the girl can write, right? Erica, did you ever take the... Okay. I can't remember either, baby. Well, we already know she's gifted. I think in administration was one of them. Leadership was another. So just know. And Pastor, you want to say anything?
It is indeed a pleasure to have both of you as part of this family. As we promised some time ago, it is our desire to walk alongside you. Amen. We recognize this as a place, and I think you struck the right chord. We're trying to develop a place of belonging. Amen. And we feel that you belong here. And so it's our job now to walk alongside you and to do all that we can to make sure that you're growing. So welcome to the family. Amen. 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 Amen.
And so if you're thinking about joining, come on. You just heard their testimonies. It's been fun. I've been looking at two back there for Sunday after Sunday. The Lord has been like, okay, y'all moving over. Y'all moving from here to here. I guess y'all, and then y'all come down, right? Anyways, I know that you raise your hand if you're in new members class right now. We've got a few more that are coming, and we got a whole row back there. So just exciting time in Brown Hutchison. God bless you. Thank you.
Good morning, church. It's good to be before you on this morning. I have the responsibility to bring forth some announcements. I think one announcement I want to share with you. You can put it on the screen. It doesn't require me to say anything at all. Isn't that right, Reverend Jesse? We have a message from our health ministry. Amen. I need us to realize we have some, again, we have healthcare professionals who are in the house. Amen. And that's not something that we should take for granted. So, first of all, there's no such thing as a stupid question. So, if you have any questions whatsoever regarding your health, I want you to seek out those four and ask your question. They can provide solid counsel. They're wise enough to know that some stuff may be beyond their expertise, right? And they're going to let you know that. But what I'm asking is please, please, please consider, again, any questions you may have, go to them and say, hey, I've been thinking, I've been wanting to ask this, ask that, and they have really, really good information for you, amen? So please take full advantage of that when you get the opportunity. Also want to... I think I recognize some folks who are celebrating some birthdays on this week. On today, we have Sister Zaria. Where's Zaria? Zaria, please stand. She's downstairs. Zaria is 17 years young today. Amen. 17 years young. We also have celebrating on this week, Brother Byron Ingram's birthday is today. Amen. Byron is not 17. Amen. He's celebrating a birthday on today. Amen. And we also have we have Alan there. No, it's Awan and Ahanu Roberts. You all remember the twins. They are the grandchildren of Reverend Dr. Walter Brame and Reverend Brenda Brame. They are our twins who we've watched grow up, but they are celebrating their birthdays on March the 7th. Amen? Amen. 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 Also want to recognize, again, ask the question, is anybody here who's celebrating a birthday or anniversary that we did not catch? Okay, Renee, when is she? Yesterday. Yes, Renee Reese, amen. I think we lifted you up. We definitely mentioned you on last week, but I want to recognize again Sister Renee Reese celebrating her birthday on yesterday. Anybody else? Anybody else? No, amen, amen, amen. It is giving time here at BHM, and as is the case, we have a couple of ways to engage in the process. There is the very convenient way of Givelify, which can be done by way of your cell phone or your computer. It's an online platform. We also have the envelope. Amen. If you are in need of an envelope, please raise your hand, and an usher will get you an envelope. I would be considered old school. I still use an envelope. Amen. I still write on these things called checks. Anybody know what a check is in this house? It's this little thing about this big, and it says pay to the order of, and you fill out who you're going to pay, and at the bottom right, you put your signature, and then on the left, you have memo. Amen? Anybody? It's a check. Amen? Some of us don't know what them checks are because we just, everything is, you know, computer and on our phone, amen? I like to check, so I use my envelope, amen? Amen, amen. Amen. Let's pray over the offering. Father in heaven, we bless your name. We give you thanks. We give you praise, Father. And we thank you for this opportunity, Father, to give. Lord, we do so, Father, hopefully with a cheerful heart. That's what your word requires of us, Father. And Lord, may we do so, Father, recognizing that it is something that is indeed a privilege. It is a ministry, Father. And Lord, I thank you, Father, for those of us who are, Lord, recognizing those things and giving, Father, with a cheerful heart, Father. Lord, if it's one thing that's true, it is that we can and never, in any way, I'll give you. But Father, I want to suggest, Lord, that we just continue, Lord, to give all that we can in an effort to try to outgive you, Lord. Father, it may be in time, it may be in service, Father, it may be in finances, Lord. But Father, I pray in the name of your son, Jesus, that we would all further develop a giving heart, a giving spirit, Father. For your word says it is better to give than receive. And so, Lord, we ask that you would bless these gifts, that you would help us to continue to be good stewards over them, Father, and they will be utilized in a way that brings glory to your name. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. If you're able, if you could please stand for the reading of God's word. I'm going to read on this morning from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4. Let's read together. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. Amen.
On to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give, and I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily. Sing that again together. I surrender all. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I to Jesus I surrender humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. I surrender all to thee.
Been singing that hymn for as long as I could read. Amen. That's something that I grew up singing. That's a song that is simple in its words, but how many of you would agree it's rather hard in its practice? Amen. This idea of surrendering all to Jesus. Amen. And yet that's what he expects, is for us to surrender all. And on this month, our focus is got to give it up. Got to give it up. And in particular, when I say that, it's this idea of giving up something beyond the 40 days of Lent. Amen. So for those of you who have joined us and giving something up, God bless you. I don't know if it's kicking your butt like it's kicking mine, but it's kicking my butt. But that's okay, because I can count 40 days. But how many of you know there are things that God wants us to give up forever? Like completely, amen? And he ain't said nothing about bread, amen? He didn't say that. He said we can, again, we ain't got to give it up forever, amen? But there's some stuff that he wants us to give up forever. And on this morning, I want to talk about giving up control. Control. I think it's safe to assume that in this room on this morning, as well as those who are watching, that we may just have one, maybe two, maybe 50 control freaks. I'm guessing, amen? And so, you know, to give up control is just, it's hard, amen? There's a pastor named John Ortberg. He's a writer as well. And so he wrote this piece. He says, when it was time to take our first child home from the hospital, we put her in the car seat in the back of the car, and then I got in the front seat to drive. Reverend Brenda, he says, she was so small, even the baby seat was way too big. She looked so fragile to me that I drove home on the freeway going 35 miles per hour, with the hazard lights flashing the whole time. The first day when your kid is in the car with you, it's a scary day. Does anybody want to know what the next really scary day is with your kid in the car, he asked? It's when they turn 16. And now you're handing over the keys. And now they're moving from the passenger seat, from the ride-along seat, into the driver's seat. That's a scary moment. It's a big moment in your life when you hand someone else the keys. Up until now, I've been driving, he said. I choose the destination. I choose the route. I choose the speed. You're in the drive-along seat. But if we are to change seats, if you're going to drive, I have to trust you. It's all about control. Whoever is in this seat is the person in control. A lot of people find Jesus handy to have in the car as long as he's in the ride-along seat. Because something may come up where they require his services, he said. Jesus, I have a health problem, and I need some help. I want you in the car, but I'm not so sure I want you driving. If Jesus is driving, I'm not in charge of my life anymore. If he's driving, I'm not in charge of my wallet anymore. If I put him in control, then it's no longer a matter of giving some money now and then when I'm feeling generous or when more of it is coming into my life. Now it's his wallet. It's scary, he says. If Jesus is driving, I'm not in charge of my ego anymore. I no longer have the right to satisfy every self-centered ambition. No, it's his agenda. It's his life. Now, I'm not in charge of my mouth anymore. I don't get to gossip, to flatter, to deceive, to rage, to intimidate, to manipulate, to exaggerate. I get out of the driver's seat and hand the keys over to him. I'm fully engaged. In fact, I'm more alive than I've ever been before, but it's not my life anymore. It's his life. It's his life. So on this morning, I want to talk about what it means to give up control. Again, many of us have engaged in this Lenten exercise of 40 days of practicing discipline and giving something up. There are a variety of things you could give up, as we talked about. Chocolate and pizza or social media. Others think they can give up alcohol or ice cream or the television. But the resolution made during Lent are kind of like the resolutions that we make for New Year's. They disappear soon, not to be followed. But this month, our sermon series is, again, it's entitled, Got to Give It Up. And we're going to talk each week about things that God wants us to give up, not just for 40 days, but forever, like forever, ever. Amen? You see, this morning, I want to talk about giving up control. Now, first things first, there's nothing wrong with control. Without some measure of control in the place, we would live in a very chaotic world, right? For example, traffic lights, amen? They control the flow of vehicles and allow for orderly movement to avoid collisions. Where would we be without that form of control? Anybody here ever felt a certain way when the power goes out and the traffic lights are down? Oh, my goodness. Folks just kind of forget, Keith, that what happens is supposed to be a four-way stop, right? Amen? Everybody stop. But some folk, they can't operate without the traffic lights, amen? Right? We could use an example, parents who have or don't have control of their children. Amen? I'm talking to somebody. That's right. Right? You see, here in Kent County and in most local governments, there's an office called Animal Control. We know that, right? Right? Furnaces are under the control of a thermostat, so that our house is warm when we come home. So control is not really a bad thing. Now, what's funny about this particular GIF is, okay, you see one hand, that's the male's hand. Other hand, that's the woman's hand. See, we're going to pause for a cause here. So you really can't see it, but the man's hand is turning the heat down, and the woman's hand is turning the heat up, amen? You see, I come from a household, Brother McFadden, where my daddy said, go get a sweater. Amen. But some of us live in a household now where our wives or our significant others are like, they want to feel Miami in January. Amen. House be 85. Amen. And so, I'm just saying. There's something about that. Look, get yourself a sweater, amen? Amen. So control is not a bad thing. It is the fact that control can become bad if we feel as if we need it all the time. There's the story of a pastor who, when asked by his wife what his upcoming message was going to be about, he said, giving up control. And you see, every Sunday morning, Reverend Luke, before he would leave for church, he would always leave a copy of the church bulletin and his message with his wife. So this was a natural question for her to ask. Well, after several minutes of hysterical laughter, his wife said, seriously? Really? This should be really interesting on Sunday morning. You're going to speak on giving up control? She was laughing because he was a controlling person. And I suspect that, again, right here in this sanctuary and watching online, there might be some who would say the same about yourselves. Or maybe you just might say, who, me? Well, you know, here's the thing. Denial is something else, y'all. It's real. It exists. You see, you and I are funny people. We hate to be controlled, and we do not like people who try to control us. You see, if you are a controlling person, it is irritating to be told you're a controlling person. In fact, you want whoever told you that to take it back. Amen? So this pastor I just mentioned questioned his wife, and sure enough, she had some specific thoughts, but then she said, I love you as you are. The pastor was relieved. You see, if you want to make your spouse crazy, this is advice. Tell them they are controlling, amen? They'll spend the next 30 minutes making you take it back, amen? I promise you. You see, when I think of control, I think of the terrible twos. Whoo! Terrible twos. Terrible twos. Look. Many of you, maybe you do know, maybe you don't know, but Evan has a tribe. How many children do you have, Evan? Evan has three children, amen? So I'm talking to Evan right now, amen? The terrible twos. This is what makes the terrible twos so terrible. The main job of a two-year-old is to figure out who he or she is by testing the waters, amen? He or she may not have the vocabulary for what they're doing. You won't hear a two-year-old saying, please pardon me while I test the boundaries of our relationship, but I am in a period of self-discovery and need to figure out just how much of this family I'm in control of. They won't say it that way, but they know what they're after. They're after power, amen? They want the power, Sister Verley. They want the power, Sister Verley. In those little minds of theirs, they're thinking, just how much control can I get of these two people who are raising me? I believe that. Where are the lines, and can I redraw them so they include everything I want? That's their mindset. I want to suggest that's how we learn, even in adulthood, what we can control and what we can't control. We learn by pressing the limits like a two-year-old. And our goal is to control everything we can. We want to control our finances, our futures, our families, our pets, our children, our jobs, our schedules, everything. We want control. Like Janet Jackson talked about, amen? Control. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Control. But how many of you know that control is the fallen human condition and the motivation for all spiritual rebellion? You see, we hate it. We hate it when we see control freakishness in anyone else because their need for control might mean we have to give up territory. But here's the irony in all of this.
To the degree that we try to get or keep control, we will work against our God-given design and end up owned by our own rebellion. Hear me now. This is because we are not designed for control, but surrender. So we're going against the design. God didn't design us to be in control. He designed us to be in surrender. Let that sink in. I want to suggest some scripture examples and see if we can consider some life-changing ideas. The Bible story of the first man and the first woman is a story about control. Adam and Eve. They had it made, y'all. They lived in paradise. Food was provided. They didn't have to put up with snow. Oh, man. Or rain, or cold. They could do whatever they wanted except for one thing. Just one thing. There was a tree in the garden, a tree that God called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And they were instructed not to touch or eat of its fruit. That's it. Just one restriction. Just one. But don't we hate one specific restriction? We will work to get around it, won't we?
You can't tell me I can't go that way. I know what the sign says, but if I want to go that way, I'm going to go that way.
There's something about a restriction. But as we know, these first two humans fell prey to the deceits of the serpent, who is described as a tempter in the NIV. Other translations call him most clever and shrewdest of all the wild animals. You see, the serpent's appeal to Eve was an appeal to her ego. You won't die if you eat that fruit, girlfriend. The serpent's message to Eve was very clear. Serpent was like, God just doesn't want you to know what he knows and be as powerful as he is. God wants to control you. It doesn't have to be that way. You can be in control yourself. God's just hating on you. And of course, Adam followed right along. And how they must have enjoyed not only the delicious fruit, because how many of you know when you get to something that you're not supposed to have, it tastes all the more sweeter? Can I get a witness? But now they were in control of their life, or so they thought. Now, I want us to compare Adam and Eve with Jesus' encounter with the devil in the scripture that we read this morning from Matthew chapter 4. You see, this time the devil is described quite appropriately as the tempter. We were talking about temptation throughout our Bible study on Wednesdays in February. Temptation's something else, ain't it? My goodness. You see, Jesus had gone into the wilderness under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. He was led there to fast and pray in preparation for his public ministry, which would follow. He was tired, y'all. He was weak. And just then the devil shows up. You see, Adam and Eve were tempted with the fruit of a tree, but look what Satan offered Jesus. First thing he did was food, some grub, amen, to satisfy his hunger. He said, hey, man, just turn these stones into bread. Jesus, you can do it. You're hungry, aren't you? But Jesus, he knew the scriptures. And do you remember what it said in Deuteronomy chapter 8? That life is more than just bread. True life is feeding on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil suggested that Jesus do a miraculous stunt to jump off the highest point of the temple. Oh, how popular you will be, Jesus. Your name will be in the newspaper or on the evening news reports. People will come from near and far to meet this daredevil who survived such a fall. The devil was doing his best crisscross impression. Amen. That was his thing. Just jump, man. But Jesus, he couldn't do that. That would be taking control from God, to whom control of his life belonged. The devil tried one more time. This time he showed Jesus all the kingdoms of the world. Look, Jesus, have you ever seen such splendor? Look at all the riches. Look where you will be living. You will have the admiration and respect of all these people. You will be king of the world. But Jesus didn't take this bait either. The control of Jesus' life did not belong to him, but to his heavenly Father. The control of Jesus' life did not belong to him, but to his heavenly Father. The control of our life does not belong to us, but to our heavenly Father. The control of our life does not belong to us, but to our heavenly Father. And Jesus could never, ever worship the devil. Jesus let, he let God be in control. And I got news, y'all. He's still in control. Still in control. Amen. Even to this day, Amen. He's still in control. Amen. But you and I, we have trouble giving up control, don't we? Amen. And some people take this thing of control to an extreme. In fact, I did my research. It was in the late 1960s that somebody came up with that term to describe this phenomenon, control freak, 1960s. Do you know anybody like that? Pause. How about the following? You might be a control freak if you think that someone should change one or two things about themselves and you'd be happier. So you try to help them change this behavior by pointing it out, usually over and over. You might be a control freak if you micromanage others to make them fit your expectations. You might be a control freak if you find yourself using phrases like, "This is for your own good. I'm only trying to help you." Or, "You'll thank me later for this." Of course, we never use these phrases, do we? You might be a control freak if you judge with disapproval the behavior of others and then withhold your attention and approval until they fall in line with your expectations. Saints, you might be a control freak if you offer what you call constructive criticism to others as a way to advance your own agenda. Look, I know I'm in somebody's Kool-Aid right now. I know I am. I know your flavor and everything. Amen. I do. And I want to suggest that control freaks, they're on the prowl. And it seems they're everywhere. We all know one or two, don't we? Or maybe it's us. We're the control freak and we don't want to admit it. Here is something for us to consider. Let's be kind and loving and accepting. God is in control and we're not. How about that? In fact, peep this. We each have more than enough to do to take care of our own life. So let's let others live their lives without our controlling. Let's not only give up control for Lent. Let's give it up for good. For good. In New York City, on Fifth Avenue, there's a place called St. Patrick's Cathedral. And there behind the high altar is a little shrine of the boy Jesus. Perhaps he's 8 or 9 years old. And with no effort, he is holding the world in one hand. You see, we have a choice. We can carry the world on our shoulders, or we can say, I give up, Lord. Here's my life. I give you my life. You see, God told the Israelites, if you want freedom, you have to leave what you know and head for the desert. Jesus told his followers that if you want to gain your life, you have to lose it. What does it profit you, he said, if you gain the whole world, but you lose your own soul? And the Bible's prescription for the sickness of control is always surrender. Surrender. Often defined in the scripture as a call to wholeheartedness. And the Bible's promise is that if we will lean into surrender, we will find freedom. Amen? We talked about that last month. You see, when we choose to surrender over control, we are choosing peace over anxiety. Sounds like a major benefit to have our anxiety reduced, doesn't it? Amen? If we surrender, we are choosing peace. Anybody here want some peace? Anybody here see the benefit of surrender? You got to give it up. Control, got to give it up. Got to let it go. How many of you all are familiar, I want to close with this, how many of you all are familiar with carpal tunnel syndrome? Some of you might suffer from carpal tunnel syndrome. Carpal tunnel syndrome, also called median nerve compression, is a condition that causes numbness, tingling, or weakness in your hand. And part of it is, saints, is the fact that you're always using your hands. Some of us have long suffered from spiritual carpal tunnel syndrome because we just don't want to let it go. We can't imagine our life without having control. And we're suffering, amen? We're suffering. In fact, it says that what happens with carpal tunnel syndrome is you have a burning, tingling, or itching numbness in your palm and thumb of your or your index and middle finger, weakness in your hand, and trouble holding things, shock-like feelings that move into your fingers, tingling that moves up into your arm. That's a whole lot of pain that could go away if you simply let it go. Control. Is there anybody here who desires to let go? If you're able, if you please stand. Before we have Holy Communion, I want to pray. I want to pray this morning in particular for this weakness that we have. I also want to recognize the folks who are on the board who are asking for prayer. I want to ask you all to please join me in praying for our own Reverend Dr. Walter Brame, who lost his sister. Sister Joyce Moreau's name is up there under peace. And he went to bury his sister down in Fayetteville, North Carolina. Amen. And so we're lifting up Reverend Dr. Brame and his siblings and Joyce's family, amen. But we've been lifting her up for peace for some time now. So I ask that you would lift up Reverend Dr. Brame in your prayers throughout the course of this week and beyond, amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we confess our need for you today. We need your healing and we need your grace. Father, we need hope restored. We need to be reminded that you work on behalf of those that you love and that you do so constantly and powerfully and completely. Father, forgive us for trying to fix our situations all on our own. We come to you on this morning and bring you the places we are hurting. We ask for your healing and grace to cover every broken place. We release to you this day every need and problem we've carried or tried hard to control. We believe in your goodness to see us through. We love you, Lord. We need you on today. God, we keep thinking that if we are in control, things will go well. But deep in our soul, we know that's not true. And we give up control to you, for you are God, and we are not. Thank you, oh God, for your love and your forgiveness of our sins. We give up control right now in the name of your son, Jesus. We pray this prayer in the matchless and miraculous name of your son, our brother and our savior, Jesus the Christ. And all God's people said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Reverend Luke.
Thank you, Pastor. When I was growing up in Malaysia, in the Anglican church, there's some church furniture I got to get used to. They didn't have the altar, which really didn't make as much sense till later in life. But there was the communion table and the baptismal font. Whether it was a tub or whether it was a sprinkling bowl, didn't matter. But there were two signs of church furniture. And for a long time, we didn't even have a cross. And a good pastor saw to it that we got a cross. You'll notice that there is a table in front of the pulpit, and there's some dinnerware. There's a chalice for the wine and a plate for the bread. Pastor and I have been talking for a long time, and we talked about different things, and we said, it'll be nice to have some of the furniture in the house of God, right? But at some point, it'll be more than just furniture. We'll actually have a loaf of bread on the plate and have some grape juice or wine in the chalice. And so when I read the portion that we normally read about on the night when Jesus was betrayed, took bread and we gave thanks, we can actually break the bread and we can actually pour the wine or the grape juice in the chalice, all in an effort so that we can engage our memories and remember that fellowship meal that Jesus had just before he died. And the reason we want to remember is the same reason the Israelites were asked to remember when the Passover lamb passed over their house because of the blood on the doorpost. We as creatures of God need visual, tangible reminders of the story of our God and his mighty acts. So we're not into rituals so much, but we are into building and creating memories, okay? This morning for our reading, before we read the portion from First Corinthians, I want to read from the book of Isaiah because it's the season of Lent. And I want to read excerpts from Isaiah 53 that reminds us why we're here and why we gather around the table. Isaiah reminds us that surely he took our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Let us pray. God, we are grateful we can gather around this table this morning. Grateful to be reminded that you went all the way to Calvary's cross so that we can have life, abundant life. But you invite us to come knowing that your Son bore our sins. Your Son died our death. Your Son experienced the separation that we deserved. And you invite us to come humbly, confessing, letting go, reaching out to grasp your hand even as you extend your hand to ours, so that we can have newness of life, so we can walk as new creatures, born from above, born again, born and restored as your sons, adopted sons and daughters. So accept our prayer, encourage and strengthen our wills so we can walk humbly with you throughout this week. For we ask in Jesus' name, amen. The Apostle Paul reminds us that on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Drink ye all of it in remembrance of me. For as much as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Amen. Take, eat, remember and believe that the precious body of our Lord Jesus Christ was given for the complete forgiveness of all of our sins. Take, drink, remember and believe that the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ was shed for the complete forgiveness of all of our sins. Together with the psalmist, we say, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." Why do we bless God? Because he forgives all of our sins, heals all of our diseases, redeems our life from the pit, and crowns us with love and compassion. He satisfies our desires with good things so that our youth can be renewed like eagles. Please rise for the blessing. Receive God's blessing and go home in peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and grant you peace. Amen? Amen. God be with you.